Thanks for hearing me. Mark just explained what PhotonTelder does, so I'm not going to repeat that. As part of what we try to do, to basically our goal is to help the Dutch ecosystem grow to a level of 1 billion in revenue and 4,000 jobs by 2026 by leveraging basically the good knowledge position that the Dutch country has, as well as a lot of startups. In order to do so, we do a number of things. The financial part was already mentioned, but we also help with advice. We also help with market investigations. And for that reason, we also develop roadmaps to share in order to boost the potential for integrated and in general photonics. Now, in this case, I'm going to talk about automotive. And automotive is a very interesting and challenging area. Which is undergoing very revolutionary changes. So I'm going to explain a little bit about what they call the mega trends for that first, and looking at what that could mean for the development of electronics, and specifically, of course, photonics and such in vehicles, and then moving on to a few examples that are explaining where integrated photonics can play a role. Well, first of all, the automotive environment, mobility environment, is going to be quite interesting area for the coming decades, because it's facing three revolutionary changes at the same time. One is electrification. The combustion engine is on its way out. Electrical cars are going to be the future. That is a complete different drivetrain for a car than it was before. So that's a revolutionary change. At the same time, there's a drive to do more and more on drivers ADAS, that's driver support systems. And in the end, that will end up in autonomous vehicles. So that's also a very huge change in the way we look at car and mobility. The third part is that the future is likely not going to be only looking like replacing a combustion engine 1500 kilo car by an electric one. You will see different mobility patterns. You see different type of electric vehicles. You will see, because of autonomous driving, robo-taxis and robo-transporters, and last but not least, because of the climate change processes, but also because the pressure on the population in cities. There are now discussions about so-called sustainable cities, which is basically putting the car second or third place in what's in the roads within the city center. And that means it will change the traffic patterns considerably. The combustion engine at the same time has its difficulties. Not really helped by the so-called Schumer scandal, and so they get more and more tough legislation demands, making it more and more difficult and hard to meet them. But the consequence is that there is a very strong accelerated innovation in vehicles towards power electronics and sensors and both in the powertrain as well as in the autonomous driving characteristics. That costs an enormous amount of money, which means that you also see the landscape in the car industry change. Corporations focus on new technologies away from combustion engine vehicles. So the car makers, especially in Europe, but also in the rest in China, they are facing strong pressure to change. In Europe, they have to manage the total emissions of their fleet or face huge penalties. Which means that they have to do something, especially because they sold lots of SUVs in the past and still. And that means that they will start massively introducing hybrid cars in various forms. For this reason, short term, long term, the market will start moving towards electrical vehicles. Expectation is battery prices will fall. I think there are about 140 mega factories being built at the moment to produce batteries in the world. So battery prices are expected to fall. Overall, this will probably lead to a 15% full EV market share by 2030. And since this is not a linear, but a more, let's say, Moore's law type of the change, the expectation is that transition will go very fast after that in developed countries. Now I'm going to piss off the petrol heads. EVs have superior driving characteristics and superior efficiency compared to the combustion car. And the consequence is that since they're still more expensive, but nevertheless, cost parity on total cost of ownership is expected, let's say, in the 2024 timeframe. So that's not that far away. On the other hand, car makers have been dragging their feet, exception of course Tesla, developing EV platforms, drivetrains, battery packs is extremely expensive, billions and billions. So to give you an example, I think Volkswagen plans to put 90 billion in the coming years to catch up. Not every car maker is able to fork up that amount of money. So what you will see is alliances or simple car makers disappearing. China, of course, will have their own internal play with lots of electric car makers that are going probably to cooperate as well. If you look at the graph at the site, you'll see that Europe and China are going to lead the way in this area. The rest of the world is going to follow more slowly. And in terms of the of mobility, North America is the desert of advanced vehicles, I'm afraid. Tesla being the obvious exception. That's for cars. Trucks will have their own dynamics. Expectation was that it will take a long time, but you see already a fast move towards hybrid and EV trucks for short distance deliveries, and also changes towards smaller vehicles for delivery as well. Long haul, there is not yet a clear picture yet. It might go into the direction of hydrogen and fuel cells. It might be something else as well. Hybridization is probably the first step. On the bus side, and people living in Eindhoven know, city buses go electric very, very fast. Then, moving on to the next trend. Autonomous driving has been a huge hype in the past years, and several companies were announcing level 5, that is full autonomous driving, in the coming years. That hype has gone away. So Tesla is still maintaining a lot of it, but the rest is becoming more cautious, at least for open roads. So that takes place is 2030 will be more or less the time frame, not the coming years. And huge investments are still being made, but now probably the most of them use the path of going first to improve driver assistance systems and then moving it step by step into a more higher level autonomous car. So you'll see level 2, 3, 4 cars coming up in the coming years. That is not the case for what they call controlled environments. So in warehouses, industrial areas, airports, and that type of environment, you will see faster uptake of robo transport and robo taxi type of activities. The reason for that is that it's a more simple environment, so it's less complicated to control. And secondly, a robo taxi can be much more expensive, because the business case for a car that will do a transport without a driver is creating a pretty strong business case. However, that means the car really gets a lot more expensive. As you can see on the graph, the amount of sensors going into a car with an increasing level of autonomy is pretty steep. And that, of course, is exactly why this is such good news for people who are making sensors, including photonics. Then the new mobility patterns. That's the third trend, and all of them will happen at the same time. So what the consequence eventually will be is a very interesting question. It's probably a lot with a lot of interesting surprises along the way. Nevertheless, one thing that's very clear is that urbanization, more and more people in the world will live in dense populated cities, will put pressure on the available space. And a lot of cities have lots of space in roads and they need that space. So it needs to be greener as well, also to avoid heat overload in the cities in hot summers, for instance. So the trend is towards basically moving roads to other forms of mobility than cars. Less roads, different more forms of mobility. The other thing is, of course, parking problems, depending on where you are. That's can be a very huge, serious problem, and extremely expensive as well, especially for people who live, people living in Amsterdam probably will know. So, alternative transportation has come up. E-bikes, e-motors, e-steps, you name it. And those all will have to start to play a role in the overall mobility system. The other thing is that cars stand still for basically 90% of the time, so sharing services have become more popular as well. That's not, of course, if you're living in the countryside, that's not very practical, but in the city, it is. Now, then you have to still have to find all those things, except of breaking your neck over a step in some cities that have an overload of them. So you need integrated services to find your what they call multimode transport and handle it through your smartphone. Now, there's a lot happening in that area as well, so that's also moving up quite rapidly. Now then, robo-taxis can fulfill a large part of the last mile transports. That's why Uber has invested a lot of it, and they're not the only ones. We call it sometimes also Uberification of mobility. And what you can do for transporting last miles for people, of course, also applies for delivering packages into city centers by autonomous transport as well. So those things are also going to change the way we work. So less roads, less cars, more mixed traffic patterns. Shared cars that drive more kilometers will recycle faster, and that means a huge change in every aspect of the mobility chain. Now, that's going to be quite exciting in a way for our lives, but also for the businesses that we're talking about. And what does this mean actually for integrated photonics? Or for photonics in general, I take a bigger picture first and give a few examples of integrated examples later on. So, electric vehicles require different sensors than combustion engine vehicles. You see in the graph, the bottom, you see that growth in sensors is very fast, especially in ADAS systems. You say, well, why bother about powertrain? That's effectively not true, because the sensors in a combustion engine are a completely different set of sensors than what is in a powertrain. So consequently, that's a complete changeover. The two biggest areas are the powertrain, including the battery management, which is very important in a car. If you don't measure the state of charge, state of health, state of function of a battery, you can get big problems or lifetime problems, or all kinds of other problems. ADAS systems, I already mentioned. And as I showed already in a previous graph, the more autonomous the car, the more sensors you need. And in trucks, and I add drones here as well, you can say, what the hell have drones to do with automotive? Well, there are already experiments going on, for instance, by UPS with drones on the roof of delivery vans to deliver the packages for the last 100 meters or something like that. So, and it's definitely an area that is growing and will require lots of sensors. Now, if you look at the typical segmentation in a car, you see the ADAS and autonomous driving system, which you put on top. You have LiDARs, cameras, detectors of all kinds. Of course, radars, but they're not photonic. You see the drivetrain, battery management, temperature, pressure, strain, displacement are important parameters to measure the health of such a package. In the cabin, temperature, of course, but that's not a very complicated area. But air quality is an issue, not necessarily in every country, but certainly in the more polluted ones. You have functions like gesture control, what is called driver well-being, where the driver is being, or even the passengers are being monitored by cameras using structured light to measure the way they behave and whether they are fatigued or whatever. So that's an interesting area. In the infotainment area, it's not integrated photonics, but the different displays, heads-up displays and things like that, even holograms are playing a role. Connectivity is going to be huge, because an autonomous car will be a networked car, both internally and externally. The amount of data that has to be processed with all those sensors is really staggering. You're talking about terabytes per second that have to be processed internally, and so that's really huge. And also externally, cars are getting connected. Of course, they have already connections through the mobile 3, 4, and 5G, but it will expand to vehicle to vehicle and vehicle to infrastructure communication, which can be electronic or also partly optical. And you will have huge car networks that have to transport all those data back and forth in order to get to the right decision levels on your autonomous vehicle or your warning system. And all of that has to be secure. Also there, potentially photonic security systems can play a role. It's really an important thing. It's already important for your computer at home, but you don't really want your computer that drives your car to get hacked and create traffic jams or drive you into a wall or whatever. So that's really an important item in everything here. Then body and chassis. Gyroscope is an example where less interfering systems like an optical gyroscope could play a role. And of course, lighting. Lighting by and large is LEDs and VCSELs and things like that, but also all kinds of structured lighting are being deployed right now, which is not a necessary integrated photonics, but definitely a photonics application. All right, I move on. The last examples. Now I'm going to look at the more integrated photonics examples. LiDAR being a very obvious one, was already mentioned a few times. You have different systems for that. The market is expected to grow very fast because it's a complementary technology to the existing cameras and radars. So combined, you get a sensor fusion, which is much more reliable than single systems in itself. There are different systems at the moment. Most prominent are time of flight and frequency modulated coherent wave. Time of flight, you see on the right, is using very short laser pulses of nanoseconds, and you measure basically the time when the signal gets back. In order to do so, you need very fast, very strong, high powerful pulses in the infrared area, and a very sensitive array, most often a SPAD array, to do so. You can do that in different ways, using a strong laser and a MEMS mirror to steer the beam, or using a VCSEL array, which is effectively an array of thousands of different VCSELs on a chip to send sufficient pulses out and to be able to detect. Now, frequency modulated coherent wave can use integrated or uses integrated photonics, because there you really need a tunable laser. You modulate that laser and you basically can detect very sensitively the signal that's coming back, and based on the both on the combination of the frequency you measure as well as the change, because you also measure the Doppler effect, you can also measure the speed of the vehicle in front of you. It does mean tunable lasers, phase arrays, all kinds of beam control things, gratings, and a coherent detection system, which are all things you can put together in an integrated photonic chip, which is an area that is really getting a lot of additional traction at the moment. So those are examples of what it can mean in ADAS systems and autonomous driving. Now I switch to another one, which is more in the battery, for instance, in the battery area system. It's also already deployed in aeroplanes, and effectively Ivana was already mentioning in an endoscope application where a similar system is also used, but then only with one measurement point. They call it so-called fiber break grating interrogators, and what you basically do is you send laser pulse, laser signal into a fiber which has gratings in different places, which are absorbing or reflecting the signal at a certain frequency based on the shift that is caused by either strain or temperature change or pressure, depending on how you use it. You can measure very, very sensitively, and I mean very sensitively, nanoseconds, nanometers. Sorry, there is some noise in the environment suddenly. Nanometers or very small displacements. And that's being used in, for instance, also steppers, but also in other. But you can also do this in multiple spots. If you change the gratings, you can actually measure different places by measuring different frequencies. So you can use up to hundreds of points at the fiber in order to do so. The hundreds of points allow you to measure as many places in a car, for instance in a battery pack or in other places. So that is an area where you can see very cost-effective solutions if you want to measure a lot of points. Of course, you can expand it to non-car applications like aeroplanes, like pipelines, like bridges, where the effects are also used. Advantage being insensitive to magnetic and electric fields, insulating, and the system can be extremely compact compared to other systems. So, That gives you a feeling, I hope, for what possibilities there are and going to develop in integrated photonics in the coming years in the vehicle, how the market will basically help us to grow the number of applications. And that's my last slide.